Here's a plan. On Tuesday, remember I taught you about all these general concepts of symmetric classes and Dirac and how to compute invariants, etc. And today, we are supposed, at least that was the program says, to talk about topological programming activity. Now I'm saying, really, because this is a shared presentation, I mean, I will do the first half, the second half will be done by Andre, and our work division is that I will focus on one-dimensional superconductor being wired, and Andre will do two-dimensional. Now, as far as I'm concerned, the way I would like to organize this now as follows. I would be very basic, this would be just blackboard. And by basic, I mean so basic that every person in this room should understand every single line. I mean, really, extremely simple. One by one. And I will go through a hands-on example and construct the Majorana family bound state from the simplistic model of a spin orbit coupled semiconductor wire. Yeah. Now, that is not too thrilling. I mean, in the end, we will have a Majorana family sitting there. The advantage is that in a very simple context, you will see all these concepts I introduced in abstract terms in Tuesday. We see them at work. I mean, identification of symmetry classes, hierarchization, etc. So I hope that illustrates some of the concepts. And from my experience, the types of calculations we will be doing is a shortcut.
Alex,
yes. Repetitive. I mean, So they appear, at least in my life, they appear all over the place, and that's why I think they are useful. So if I have time left, I will switch to the the presentation mode and show you a little bit about real life Majoranas and how they were detected, etc., and what the issues were, etc. Yeah? Okay, so that's the plan. And I've, the notes are updated. I mean, I sent them to you. They are updated. So it's all in the notes. So it means you don't have to copy. You don't want to. So let's start from a model of a one dimensional model of a spin orbit coupled semiconductor from the perspective of a person who hates band structure. I mean, as simple as it gets. I hope there are not too many band structure aficionados here. Yeah, but you will forgive me. So, very simple. What is this? This is white. He gave it to me. I wondered, yeah, but that's the same. So, 1D spin orbit coupled. Yeah, the semi is not so essential here. Conductor. So, stupid cartoon of a band structure. The simplest dispersion relation we can write in 1D is would be just a parabola, everybody knows, I mean free fermion in one dimension. But now we want to impose the rule that somehow momentum is coupled to spin by spin-orbit interaction. And what that means in concrete terms is that we will be dealing with a dispersion relation that looks like this. And I mean, ideally mirror symmetric, such that these guys here, we're dealing with spinful fermions, are the spin down electrons, and these ones here are spin up. Yeah? Now, kind of simplest Hamiltonian that gives us a structure of this type can be written in second quantization as sum over momenta, this here is energy, and then we write down our creation operators of this sigma is spin. I mean, plus minus 1 in my notation, and k is momentum. And here we have an k squared over 2m. And now I couple the momentum linearly to spin. And I do that by writing here a sigma, which is plus minus 1, I mean, up and down. linearly momentum, and then a parameter which on dimensional grounds must be a velocity to give it the dimension energy. And I don't care too much about this V, only that this determines the shift. I mean, we're essentially dealing here with a shifted parabola, yeah? Simple. Good. C, K, sigma. All right, so that's our Hamiltonian. Now, so far, everything is in a way, I don't know how to call it properly, but it's metallic, yeah? I mean, we put the Fermi energy anywhere, it will, you will have states. We can also anticipate, I mean, I will add some interesting stuff to this in a second, but the most interesting part in this dispersion, obviously, is this one. Yeah. So here, at least approximately, we have a linear chiral band of spin-up electrons and spin-down electrons then at the other chiral branch. And that is what is sometimes called in the slang of the field a helical liquid. Fancy word, but that's what it means, yeah? Spinful, I mean, linear dispersion. And what I will do, I am anticipating that interesting physics is here. I linearize my Hamiltonian such that it describes you the zoom-in area. And
K is one dimensional.
So
sigma of K is sigma x
times
K.
Sigma is plus minus 1. There is no Pauli matrix here. It's just plus minus 1. I mean, that would mean no 2 by 2 is fine. Mm-hmm. So I write now an effective Hamiltonian which describes here this region by linearization. And that one I switch to a real space representation. And I can then be written like such. I introduce a field. That's just the real space continuum version of these guys. And it has x as an argument, it's suppressed, it also carries spin. And here now the upwards branch becomes an I times derivative in x direction. And I have a plus minus fracture depending on the spin, that is here this sine factor, plus minus, yeah. And on top of that, I mean, let me just add, I mean, I should have added it here, some chemical potential, which I can use to shift my Fermi energy here a little bit. So, and that's it. And I set the velocity. I try to set as much to unity as I can. So velocity is set to unity. Yeah, sorry, give it the correct dimension. All right, so that's a boring, gapless, relativistic approximation of this helical liquid. Now, I want to move towards the topological superconductor, so I have to move towards the superconductor in the first place. And I will do that now by adding two gap opening instances here. One will be a Cooper gap, I mean by a pairing gap, and the other one will be a Zeeman gap. I introduce a magnetic Zeeman field, so I introduce two independent types of gap instances at at number one, a Zeeman magnetic field. And that Zeeman field will point in x direction. X direction, yeah, not z direction. Z direction would be boring. It would just shift these guys up and down a little bit in x direction. So something like which on an operator level, when I consider this here as two-component piece would be a sigma x, sorry, sigma x. So it couples sigma and anti-sigma, this gap, yeah? So I can write this in a notation where I switch now from sigma equals plus to right-moving fields and sigma equals minus to left-moving fields. You see, left and right moving is locked to the spin degree of freedom, so I can interchangeably use it. Right and left movers of spin up and spin down, the same information. It will at the following HB proportional to B integral dx psi bar left psi right plus Hermitian conjugate. couples left and right movers. Yeah. Now, what will happen here, I mean, this is now just quantum mechanical perturbation theory. If I couple them, these guys, I mean, you just open a gap, a Zeeman gap in the dispersion. And if you put your chemical potential close to zero, which I will assume most of the time, you will turn our formerly metallic guy into an insulating structure here. Okay, so that was one gap. Now add another gap. You can ask why add more than one gap. I mean, it's already a gap, but we will see it's a little bit more interesting. Next gap is due to superconductivity. I assume that my semiconductor or metallic structure is in proximity to an S-wave superconductor. And the superconductor will export its pairing gap into this structure, and it does so by introducing a superconducting gap, an ordinary S-wave gap, and that's described by H delta, which, oh no, I can write like this, integral dx delta. See, an S-wave, I mean, superconducting gap means spin up, spin down, or left, right, are coupled, and emission quantity. And that one, by itself, would turn our system into a superconductor. And it will likewise open a gap here, right? A Cooper gap. Everybody with me? Yeah? Good. So now we can ask ourselves the question, what happens if we turn on both simultaneously at the same time, I mean delta and B? And maybe the instinctive reaction is, well, you get a gap on top of a gap, so even more of a gap. But maybe somebody can give me a hint why something more interesting could happen if I turn on magnetic field and superconductivity at the same time. Yeah? Yeah, exactly. Precisely, yeah. So magnetic field and superconductivity, they hate each other, so they fight. They don't cooperate. Yeah. So chances are that somehow there will be something going on and at some characteristic strength. And since everything here has been reduced to a minimum of parameters, we may expect that at B equals delta, the system goes gapless again. That's indeed what happens. Now we want to see this in constructive terms and write down a matrix which comprises now all players into one structure. Yeah, the matrix Hamiltonian. I write this the effective Hamiltonian as some capital psi and then some matrix. Well, whatever. Right. And capital psi. Must now have a Nambu structure because we have this type of coupling here. It must have a Gorkov, however you call it, Bogoljubov particle hole structure. And the way I arrange it is I have left movers, anti-left movers, particles and holes, and the same for the right movers. All this transposed. Oh, no. No, like this. And now, yeah, our Hamiltonian now is a 4x4 matrix. And you can read it off from here. And I write now this 4x4 matrix. It has a 4x4 structure. There's I dx plus mu, I dx minus mu, minus I dx plus mu, minus I dx. That's new. This is just the kinetic part, always here, particle hole, but in moving in different directions. And in the left-right moving sectors, I have both my magnetic field and the order parameter sitting. Yeah, they are both left-right, a couple left and right. And the magnetic field enters like this. Must be So combined to an Hermitian structure, and the order parameter sits here. Delta. And to simplify the notation, let me gauge the order parameter to a real. I mean, I can always apply a phase gauge transformation to make it real, and that's our Hamiltonian. No, they have not. There is a sign change from particle to Hood. You see, I mean, if you the way I remember this, if this is Hamiltonian, this is minus H transpose. Minus H transpose. So here you have a double sign change because the X under transposition change is already signed. A chemical potential changes. That's all Hamiltonian. So if you look at this, we don't see maybe too much at first sight. I mean, but the way we should conceptualize this, I mean, is it Dirac Hamiltonian? This is kind of Dirac-ish structure in the presence of some mass, some massive, and this mass now has a tensorial structure, some matrix structure, in which reflects the symmetry of the problem, and we have to make sense of that. So the way I usually approach such problems now. Can be done differently. Let's try to figure what symmetry class this is. Remember I introduced these 10 symmetry classes? It must be in one of the 10. So, and we can do this by some guesswork, right? We can figure it out. So, there's time reversal to consider in charge conjugation symmetry. And these two usually fix this situation. So time reversal, does it have it or not? No, because there's magnetic field, right? So time reversal should be out. Charge conjugation, yes. But the question then is, what kind of charge conjugation? I mean, does it square to what, minus one or one? I mean, remember, minus one is when we have spin one half structure present. And one can be of mixed opinion here. I mean, on the one hand, there is a spin one half. But on the other hand, the spin is enslaved to the orbital degrees of freedom. So chances are it's a non-spinish situation. Yeah, I mean, the spin is already frozen in some sense. And if you formulate that guess, I mean, you can always check it whether you got it right. We would be in symmetry class called D. D means no time reversal and charge conjugation squaring to one. Yeah. In concrete terms, that means that we must find a symmetric matrix, some Pauli-like matrix, typically sigma x or even no unit matrix, such that under transposition, the Hamiltonian must go into its negative. That's the hard test. I mean, and indeed, we can check that h equals minus x transpose. Can do the test where this sigma x here acts in particle space. Yeah. So if you transpose the Hamiltonian and apply that structure, you get a minus sign. Was that was an essential step? So is it okay? What I mean? I mean, yeah. So we have a class D Hamiltonian sitting there, and now we can look up the periodic table. I mean, this periodic structure. We are in one dimension. Class D in one dimension is a Z2 topological insulator. So there must, in principle, we are we have the stage set for discovering some topology, and the only remaining piece is now to actually do it. I mean, to find some topology going on. And one way of, I mean, there are different ways of doing that. We can start to classify and think in terms of homotopy. A more hands-on approach is to formulate the working assumption or hypothesis that for large B, the system is one phase, for large delta, it's in another. For B equals delta, it's probably critical. We have to check that. And if that's the case, then we can tune the system through a critical point where it goes gapless. And if we do that in a spatial manner, so say at B, spatial x minus infinity, we have large magnetic field. And at spatial x plus infinity, we have large delta. Then, if it is topological, and that's a hard test, we must have a zero mode sitting close to x equals zero. And that will be the surface state of the corresponding topological entity. Yeah? So let's try to discover that guy. There comes a little technical point. Namely, if you just stare at this matrix, I mean, maybe you see it, but I mean, if B is delta, how do we see that it's gapless? I mean, Yes, sigma x, thank you, is sigma x particle whole tensor 1 in left right space. So it acts in these blocks. Yeah, and is in passive in that. Now, in some sense, it's clear here everything is nicely diagonal, and to understand what's going on here, we should try to get this into an as diagonal form as is possible. And that's achieved by a little linear transformation. And the linear transformation I want to do is the following. I introduce a new fermion field, eta L, left, equals 1 over square root of 2. The left moving fermion field plus its complex conjugate, here this guy. And eta left 1 over square root of 2i left minus. So any idea what these guys are? Just some fields, or can you put a sticker on them? They are Majorana fields. Yes, prime. There are two independent Majorana fields. So you can think of psi, the complex field, as essentially as eta plus I eta prime. Yeah. So it's real and imaginary part of the complex psi. And since we suspect that something Majorana-ish will go on, that's already, I mean, you could have guessed that this is a good transformation. Now, if you stick that in, and your Hamiltonian becomes the following. So I mean, the same we do for the right fields, right? And I then introduce the field psi L, which is eta L. This is just a little bit of notation, but so which bundles these two in a component structure, and I an even bigger psi, which has the left movers and the right movers in it. And if you stick that in, you find that your Hamiltonian now assumes the form dx psi transpose. So this is a real structure now. I transpose it instead of barring. Then comes the matrix Y. See, I mean, we can really think of these as real degrees of freedom in a sense, right? I mean, this complex conjugation doesn't make sense. Or another way, complex conjugation just interchanges here. It doesn't change the field itself. And this Y now has a form, and that's essentially the last formula I need. Equals. I'm using now a Pauli matrix notation here. So this would be, for example, unit matrix plus sigma 3. And this is sigma z, and that here is I times sigma y, something like that, right? So it has a structure I dx plus mu sigma y. I e plus I delta sigma 3 minus IB minus I delta plus 3 I dx sigma y. Right, that's this. So any suggestions how the symmetry now looks? I mean, class D symmetry, which previously had that form, how does it manifest itself in that language? Just by looking at it, and it's simpler. I have something totally real here. Yes, you can say that. It is I times an anti-symmetric matrix. No, time reversal is out. I mean, it doesn't have time reversal. It's just this symmetry, which now appears in just another form. Same symmetry, different language. Yeah, this is English, this is Spanish, and same thing. But here it just because this is a real structure, and everything must be Hermitian at the same time. My only option is that this must be I times an anti-symmetric matrix. I mean, real for me is always either purely real or purely imaginary. Yeah? And you can see it. I mean, if you take the transposition, the x goes to minus 1, sigma y goes to minus 1, and here you have it as well. But that's a technicality. No, it's just something. But the advantage of this is now that you explicitly see the gap closing. Because here we have now b plus delta sigma 3. Sigma 3 is 1 minus 1. So we can see that if we simultaneously send the chemical potential to 0, that one goes, and b to delta, in the down sector here, in the whole sector, they will kill each other off. So, and then you are left with derivatives, you are gapless. Yeah? So there is a gapless sector. There are actually two, you want four Majorana bands, depending on your counting. But two of these guys will be massive in B plus delta. We forget about them. But there is a B minus delta where they kill each other. And that's the gapless branch of Majorana that's appearing. So that's the last formula, functionally. Let me do this here. So we can introduce for mu, and you can generalize this all to finite mu and ask what happens under certain conditions. I mean, this is just a nutshell version here. I set now b equals, or let me put it to minus delta. It doesn't matter. So B should be either plus or minus delta. I take here minus plus a little deviation, which I call M, like mass. We can focus on eta and forget about eta prime. Means I go here to the top sector now, and that's the one corresponding to this field. We get an effective Hamiltonian, and that is integral dx, I dx, sigma 3, plus m sigma 2, eta. And that here is now a Pauli matrix. These are all Pauli matrix now in left-right space. Here this particle hole I got rid of because I've took one, I chose the gapless branch, but I'm still left here with this left-right structure. And this Pauli matrix now acts in this left-right space. And that is the deviation between B and delta, which becomes the sigma 2. It's always Pauli matrix. It's just this sigma 2 here, left-right sigma 2. Can you understand this? So, and there is one eta missing. So what we have is an Hamiltonian which almost looks like the SSH Hamiltonian in the linearized way. The difference being that this is for Majorana fields, real fields sitting here. And here we have again, we have an anti-symmetric 2x2 structure now. And for m equals 0, it becomes gapless. That's a phase transition point. Questions to this point? That was the technical part of the calculation. Ah, okay. Let me call this here. I do something else. I call this here tau. I mean, I give them tau and these here are sigmas, right? And then I use here tau. Tau 2. So what I mean by this tau 2 is this plus I minus I thing. Yeah. Okay, that's our Hamiltonian. So what we learned from this Hamiltonian is that the system goes critical at this particular parameter configuration. We do not yet have the Majorana in our hands, right? I mean, what we mean by Majorana in this context, I mean, you can think about it in different ways. You can say that if you take the bulk system and set B equals delta, there will be a Majorana mode propagating through the system freely, right? But in a in the spirit of topological insulators, what should be on our mind is more like the following situation. We consider a system where here we have, say, B larger than or smaller than delta, and here B larger than delta, which means that M changes sign. I mean, M is somewhere here, it's positive, and then in some way goes to zero. Yeah? In the spatial profile of this M parameter. That would describe here an interface between a topological insulator configuration. I mean, I'm anticipating that large delta is a topological machine, and something which is topologically equivalent to the vacuum. And in this kind of context, we would then expect a Majorana state, not a mode, but a quantum state localized sitting here. So that would be a state. Should be a Majorana. Majorana. And it has to have strictly zero energy. Right? I mean, that will be the surface state of this topological insulator. And the information must be sitting here. I mean, that formula must know about this Majorana. And let's now, as last step, you just derive it from here. I mean, how do we get the Majorana from there? The state, not the mode. You can look at this structure here, and we can translate it now to a Hamiltonian, I mean, to a first quantized Hamiltonian, which we predict must have a zero mode, irrespective of how the detailed form of this M looks like, yeah? Provided it costs zero. So let's look at H in a first quantized representation, where it's just a 2x2 matrix. And I write it as follows. I dx minus M. I dx plus I m up to unitary equivalence. So I use the freedom to give my Pauli matrices different names, right? I mean, I work with tau 3 and tau 2. I just do a rotation in this Pauli matrix space to rotate this here to a tau 1. It's just a little more convenient to work with this block of diagonal structure. No matter what, I mean, what unitary basis I use, this guy must have a zero energy eigenstate. If M crosses, yeah? So I want to solve H some wave function equals zero. And that wave function is now a two-component wave function in left-right space. Right? This, or whatever we call here left-right, in this tau space. And well, I mean, if we plug it in, a sufficient condition to find such a wave function is the existence of solutions of dx plus minus m psi equals 0. I mean, or let me call this phi. The moment I find a solution to this equation here, to either one of them, either plus or, then I can construct such a psi just by example, by writing down something like that, right? For example, if dx plus m phi equals 0, such a two component, and that will kill off this matter. Yeah?
This will make there a scalar position.
Hmm?
This will there is a function of x.
Yes, and so m is a function of x here as well.
So you need to match them at x is 0.
No. This is, sorry. This is just some function of m of x, and I have a two-component structure sitting there, right? And now everything here depends on x. So I have a first-order differential equation now, which I need to solve, and I want to solve it in one go. Yeah.
So can you say I can wait to change tau 3 to tau?
Just it's for notation's sake. Otherwise, I would get a messier representation. I mean, then I would have the x is sitting here, and notation would be a little messy, and my solution would contain components in both sectors, and just convenience of notation, really.
The result is the same.
Huh?
The result is the same.
What is the same?
The result is the same.
Yeah. So what I did technically here is I apply a unitary matrix, fixed 2x2 unitary matrix, which rotates around the one axis, the tau 1 axis. So it transforms tau, which axis? No, tau 2 axis. Yeah, I mean, it just fixed 2x2, but geometrically, if I look at it like this, 1, 3, 2, I just rotate my tau 3 to a tau 1 by a fixed 2x2, which is some one over square root of 2 and so. Yes, it's totally messed up already by introducing my. I mean, don't think about them as left and right moving. There are some linear combinations of the native left right moving field. That's true.
Now you have a complete analogy with the
SHS
model. Hmm?
Yes, indeed. Yeah. I mean, the thing is, as in the, thanks for that remark. See, such equations always have solutions, and they are granted by some index theorem stuff on Dirac operators. So I know that I will find a solution. The only question is how, and I'm just showing you how it goes. So it's now down to a first order linear, and the key to solving it is, I mean, let me introduce some parameter theta, which is integral from some, oops, my notes are wrong. Minus L to x dx prime m of x prime. And this here will be, in my notes, I did it just the other way around. So I have now to do a reflection in my head, which usually fails. But I try. So that is a monotonously decreasing function. Why is that? Because its derivative is going down, right? So the derivative is globally negative, so it decreases this function as a function of x. And hence, I can write down something meaningful as phi of x equals integral equals theta of x. So that is well defined. And if you plug it in, you find that, the derivative acting on theta produces to you m. And if you choose now the minus sign version here, you get a 0. Yeah? So that's an explicit solution. And the way it looks, you see, if M is linear, so the integral will be quadratic. And what we have is a Gaussian function. So there will be a Gaussian sitting there at zero energy. And that Gaussian we can then use to cook up the corresponding, I lost track of the plus minus, it doesn't matter. I mean, either one of these solutions here. And that's a well-defined, unique, a single, non-degenerate, zero-energy state. It's important that it's non-degenerate, yeah? Zero energy. You see, this is an example. The particle hole symmetry here means that the spectrum is symmetric around zero energy. But we may have non-degenerate zero-energy states. And that guy, I mean, sketched here, is such a non-degenerate zero-energy state, and that's the Majorana fermion sitting. So that's the end of the construction of the Majorana from this Hamiltonian. And I don't know what am I going to. Yeah, I can. In principle, I mean, I can show you now. If you can stop here, or I'll show you a few slides on how these Majoranas were seen and experimented. Yeah, I have lots of time. Andre owes me time. You owe me time because it's not late. Oh no, that's the same thing. Yeah. Good question. Thanks. You write a normalization factor here, and they kill it. I mean, you can normalize by the full integral, and then you have a infinity by infinity. Yeah. Okay. So then I show you a few. Pictures, or not pictures, I mean. Let me briefly tell you the story of how the early attempts to actually find these Majoranas in these systems. Trying to motivate this guy to wake up, but I press standby. I hate iPads, really. So there it is, our system, again in the sketch. Do we have a, yesterday we had a laser pointer. I don't know, it's gone. Oh, it doesn't matter. Yeah, so that is our system again, now shown a little bit more, a little closer to reality. So here you should think of the semiconductor wire with spin orbit. I mean, the materials change as a function of time. Nowadays, it was indium arsenide most of the time, but it's indium aluminide. So here we have our wire with its inbuilt spin orbit. We put a superconductor in ordinary S wave in close proximity, and there is a magnetic field. Now, in reality, I mean, how the interface is done, really, you just cut your system somewhere. Yeah? So this would be vacuum corresponding to this side here, and that is our topological superconductor state. And here we have, so the theory tells us, a Majorana. Oops. I don't know why I did now, but anyway, there it is. Ah, yeah, and that is a famous plot published in 2012, where they saw the Majorana in tunneling spectroscopy. So this was really that tunneling spectroscopy done on the wire, and the state then showed, or so they tell us, Covenhoven experiment as a peak in the tunneling spectroscopic data, which probes the tunneling density of state. So it probes the state sitting there. And the experiment saw it in terms of the narrow width resonance at zero energy. Of course, I cannot resolve the mathematical peak. Relying on both, that was checked, the combined presence of magnetic field and spin orbit interaction, insensitive to the magnetic field, as long as you don't align it here with the z-axis such that it's no longer potent to maintain a gap, but sensitive to temperature, so it's a quantum effect. And in the experiment, they made sure that all kinds of candidate competing, I mean, there is, Boris Altshuler once said that he can, even after so many beers, he can list 12 different effects that will give you a mid-gap resonance in a semiconductor. But apparently they excluded the fundamental player, like Kondo effect, no Andreev bound state. That's a weak spot. I will argue that here they got it wrong. And all kinds of other things. So, and that led to the conclusion that this was a Majorana. Of course, we all love to have the Majorana, but still, I mean, that interpretation maybe was a little bit premature, at least based on the data they gave us. And it was criticized in the years later, the years to come. And, before we criticize, I mean, let's briefly walk again through the minimal model of the situation, which we just went through on the blackboard. So here's what I showed you. There is a dispersion relation. We have a magnetic field which opens the gap, a Zeeman gap at zero energy, and an order parameter, the order will open a gap around the chemical potential. If you send the chemical potential to zero, the two gaps start to talk to each other and actually to compete. And and that competition can now be done in a spatially resolved manner, or at least we can conceptualize this interface which we saw before by ramping up the magnetic field the magnetic field as a function of space, and then we will see, I mean, gap full here, gap full there, and the critical point in the middle, which we just discussed. And this leads then to this Hamiltonian, which we saw. My point now is that the nice interpretation of the Majorana, in terms of the Majorana, runs into some problems the moment we take into account that the actual experiment is disordered. And so there's translational invariance breaking in the game. And that leads to trouble. So let me briefly explain that, because it connects to a topic we discussed on Tuesday. And you will see what I mean. So here's again our situation. What I just showed you here in this little exercise is the existence of this zero energy resonance sitting there, right? But there's other states. Higher lying states. So there is in the absence of a massive gap, there is a little zoo of states, and they are symmetric around zero and spatially localized somewhere around zero. So there's a little quantum dot forming here. And we know it has one zero energy state and a few more. Okay. Now, these guys give rise to effective density of states. Yeah? I mean, you have to have states, so there is a density of states. And they form of what we call in this game a class D, because superconductor, class D effective quantum dot. And the experiment probes the zero energy density of states of this guy. Yeah? Now, what can we say about the zero energy density of states? Schematically, we should have the following. There is this huge gaps out there somewhere in, as a function of energy. But then in the middle, the density of states will show a tiny little resonance, which could be due to the Majorana or something else. Okay? And this now leads back to this to this picture we discussed on Tuesday, that even if you forget about all topology, there is still, in this little quantum dot, it has its own life. There is quantum interference going on. And what happens is that if you think about in terms of Feynman path picture, particles all the time scatter off the order parameter to holes and back. And we saw that can lead to singularities. This can be happen many, many times. And so you get some effective structures which we have to sum over. And to actually compute the density of states, and that is totally independent a priori of topology. And you can do that by field theoretical methods, which I don't want to go into here. But what you then find is this result, which I mentioned already on Tuesday, that independent of topology, there's something else going on. And it turns out that if you are in a non-topological situation, if your quantum dot has an even number of levels, I mean, suppose all this topology wouldn't exist, but we would still have a superconducting quantum dot with levels, the density of states would go like 1 plus sine S over S, where S is dimensionless energy. So it has a structure shown like here. Yeah, it's a sine epsilon over epsilon function with a peak. And that is no topology. And that the spectral weight sitting here equals 1/2. If you integrate over it, I mean, integrate this function, 1/2. If you have an odd number of levels, which means that there is a zero energy sitting there, Majorana, it so happens that this sine function changes its sign. It's now minus. I mean, you cannot see it now, I'm just telling you. I mean, it becomes a minus. But you have a delta function, that's a zero energy state. So what you have is a delta function, which goes to infinity, but it's very narrow, and a minus sign. And if you plot them such that they look the most alike, you get this density of states. So which is to say that just by monitoring the density of states, tunneling spectroscopy or disordered wire, you simply cannot distinguish whether the peak is due to a Majorana or due to dirt. Got that? Yeah? It's just not possible. And let me make this a little more, a little more flashy, concrete. So one can play with effective models which capture the symmetry and disorder, including some random matrix models. I just want to show you one plot which I like. This one here. So this one is the following. It's a spectral density of a phenomenological model, I mean, some random matrix model, as a function of what? Here's energy. This is energy. So this is a density of energy levels in the system. For example, this would be here some smeared pair of Andreev states, superconducting states. And this is some control parameter, totally phenomenological, I mean, some arbitrary parameter. And you see every once in a while there is a structure like that appearing seemingly out of the nowhere. Yeah. I mean, just some. You play with a random matrix, you diagonalize it, and somewhere as a function of parameter, it just so happens you have a low-lying pair of levels, and it looks like this. And just keep the visual effect in mind, and there's no topology here. And compare this to the published experimental data. I mean, this is the tunneling spectroscopy. Here the parameter is magnetic field, and this, again, the spectral density. They saw, you must agree, there is some similarity, right? But this is only dirt physics here. So based on this, one couldn't write in there somewhere. Anyway, so, and you can generalize this. Now, what's the status now? The one-line sentence is that Majorana has arrived. I mean, we now have it. The problem with the early experiments was they were done on apparently, it's very difficult to grow semiconductor-superconductor interfaces. It's a challenge to get this right. And in the early experiments, the interfaces were just not perfect. But now in Copenhagen, they have interfaces between aluminum and indium arsenide of monoatomistic precision. I mean, really, you can look at STM, I mean, perfect interfaces. As a consequence of these interfaces, you may remember the first plot I showed you, the experimental one. It showed a little bit sluggish. I mean, some BCS structure coming down and some peak coming up. Nowadays, I mean, I don't have plots here, but the gaps really are hard BCS gaps. I mean, they see them. In the middle of these hard BCS gaps, you see a needle shooting up when the parameters are. So the Majorana is there, and it's no mystery, of course, because it's just a 4x4 matrix we're diagonalizing. I mean, if the Majorana weren't there, this simple cartoonish band structure calculation would be fundamentally flawed. So in principle, it's there. The question is only if we can resolve it, and the answer is yes, we can. I mean, it's no, and now we can play all kinds of interesting games with these Majoranas, including topological quantum computation and braiding, etc., but that's a different story. Okay, I think I've got the time. I stop here, yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So what do you think would be the smoking gap for things in
Majorana? Ah, that's an interesting thing. If you ask this question to, I mean, Charlie Marcus usually explodes when he hears this. What will they say, braiding or?
No, it's the conductance should be not the logarithmic square of it, but should be the maximum value.
Yeah. Charlie Marcus will tell you, I mean, experimentalists never prove. We can also do braiding and whatever, but for all, what else can it be? It is. I mean, I personally was very critical. I mean, I was involved in these things, but I don't need any proof anymore. I think at this point, more interesting question is what games can we play with this guy? But, and yes, I mean, you can do for scaling of transport as a function of temperature, you can do all.
And the surface, what do you do with the Majorana?
Yeah. Yeah, the real thing is Capri next year, right? I mean, in strength. even as nice as this place, yeah.
I mean, you cannot serve better.
Yeah, that's even factored in, yeah. But after a winter, but...